After a long week of work. Yes?
Amen. Amen.
I want to invite you guys to stand and worship with us this morning as I'm going to start by reading a verse from Psalm 68. Verse 3 says, "But may the righteous be glad and rejoice before God. May they be happy and joyful. Sing to God. Sing in praise of his name. Extol him who rides in the clouds. Rejoice before him. His name is the Lord."
Who died and rose on high? Who died? Hark how the angels.
Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns.
Hey!
Good morning and welcome to Church in the Valley, where we love God, love people, and serve the world. My name is Brooklyn, and I'm so glad you have joined us today for worship. CIV is a very active church with many events happening. Here are a few of the things you may want to know about this week. We have a special birthday to celebrate. Callie Kapersky turns 10 years old on Monday, September 27. Happy birthday, Callie. We are very pleased to announce that a new pastor will be joining our pastoral team here at CIV. We are excited to welcome Pastor Abraham Samudio and his wife Alyssa, who have been pastoring the Sun Valley Church in Kelowna, BC for the past 6 years. Abraham and Alyssa will be joining us in late October, and we are looking forward to their leadership and ministry here at CIV with our high school youth and young adults. The BC Conference is hosting a virtual women's ministry retreat next Friday, October 1 to Sabbath, October 2, with guest speaker Candace Thorpe. The theme of the weekend is Jesus as a central figure of revelation and his relevance to our lives today. For more information, please visit the BC Conference website at www.bcadventist.ca. Have a look at this clip. We are well on our way to the creation of a new church photo directory. Being part of a large church can make it a challenge to get to know everyone, especially for new members. By participating in this project, you help make CIV a more welcoming and inclusive church. You can pre-register by using the link that was included in the newsletter. Portraits are being done before and after worship each Sabbath. If you are not comfortable attending church in person on Sabbath yet, but would like to be included in the church photo directory, please contact the church office at 604-514-8335, and we will set up an appointment time for you to be able to come during the week to get your portrait taken. Our online Route 66 Wednesday nights, led by Pastor David Jamieson, have started back up again. Every Wednesday night online using Zoom at 7 p.m., we have a time where you can ask any questions you would like regarding the difficult passages that you come across as you read through the Bible. You can join the group using your computer or by calling in on your phone. The information is in our weekly email. Also, if you have kids ages 5 to 12, we have an awesome online Zoom Kids Route 66 Wednesday night group at 7 p.m. just for them as they read through the Bible too. If you are a first-time guest here at CIV, we want to welcome you and thank you for joining us in worship today. We invite you to go to the Welcome Center out in the atrium after the worship service and pick up a free gift. It's our way of saying thank you for being a part of our community today. Well, that's it for this week at Church in the Valley. If you would like to receive regular updates about events at Church in the Valley, send us an email at hello@churchinthevalley.ca. and request to have your name added to our mailing list. You can also subscribe to text updates by texting the word CURRENT to 604-330-9717. Thanks once again for worshiping with us today. May God richly bless you.
Let's kneel for prayer. Father God, we bow our knees before you this morning, And we come to you through the merits of your Son, Jesus Christ. We realize this morning that without you we can do nothing, and without you we are nothing. Our lives are totally dependent on you. And so as we gather here again today, on this Sabbath day, we pray that you will come divinely close to us and bless us individually and collectively. Help us to know that your promises to us will never fail as long as we keep our eyes on you and trust in you. For you remind us that you came to this earth in order to save us, in order to reunite us with your Father. You're not a God who forced us to do things. You're the one who asked us to come boldly to your throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and pardon and strength to help in time of need. What a love. What a concern for each and every one of us. And so we pray this morning that the Holy Spirit will be divinely close to us. Help us to sense our needs. Help us to know that we are not alone. Dear Jesus, when you walked this earth, you asked the disciples a question. When the Son of Man cometh, will he find faith in the earth? And in the days to which we are living, that question comes to each and every one of us. And yet, as we continue to study your words, we find that you warned us about these days, perilous days. You said to your disciples, the end is not yet. And as we face these days, we need your help, we need your strength, we need your peace. And so this morning, I pray that you will have mercy upon each and every one of us and grant us your peace, that we will learn to rest in you and find that joy and that love that will satisfy the soul. I want to ask you this morning, dear Father, to remember all those who are sick, all those who are hurting. I pray that you'll be divinely close to them. Help them to know that you care for each and every one. I pray now that as Pastor Dave brings the message, that our hearts will be open to your words and we will be comforted, so that as we leave this place and go, we will go in peace, knowing that you promised to be with us and never leave us nor forsake us. So into your hands we commit our care and keeping. Into your hands we commit our all. For we ask these and all other mercies, dear Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. Amen. The offering this morning is for REACH, BC, and Yukon. I think if ever a time we need that type of ministry, it's now. We are living in perilous days. We are living in days that Jesus spoke about. And as we read the scriptures, we see how true those words are. So as you give your offering this morning, remember, they are going to help others. come to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior and to surrender to him. So as you go, there are two boxes on the outside that you can place your offerings as you leave the auditorium. May God abundantly bless you as we continue to worship.
Hey, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Church in the Valley, where we love God, love people, and serve the world. Happy day 7 to you. This is also the last Sabbath of September. Can you believe that September has just flown by? It's usually extremely busy and a whole lot happening in the last 2 years in September with everything that we've been facing in our world. So it's good to be almost by September. Isn't it also great that we're going to be having a brand new youth and young adult pastor coming to join us, Pastor Abraham Samudio and his wife Alyssa. Of course, they're replacing Pastor Ben and Kalmany, who went to California, and Alyssa and Abraham should be here around the third week of October. Looking forward to having them join us on staff. I also had the privilege over the past weekend to do a wedding. Take a look at this pic, and you'll see that Donna Plow married Tony Berger. And quite a story that they had. It all began at the farmer's market where Donna sells artichokes. And Tony was a customer. And when he came in, something must have caught his eye, and he kept coming back and back, started bringing pastries and eventually flowers, then asked her out, and you know how it goes. The rest of the story's history, and they're married. And I said I would share this with our congregation because they're right now in Hawaii on their honeymoon. And maybe they're watching, who knows? Congratulations to Donna and Tony. You know, we've been talking about what's next for the last few weeks. And one of the things that's been on my heart for quite a while is wanting to ask God what is next and what is best for our congregation. And so for the last 18, 19 months, I've been thinking about this whole concept of a second worship service. And we would like to survey you, the congregation, to see if you'd be interested, some of you, in a second worship service at 9:30 in the morning on Sabbath. It'll be essentially the same format as this service, except we'll be singing more hymns. It'll be a little more traditional. And so if you're interested in that kind of a worship service at 9:30 on Sabbath mornings, there's going to be a hard copy of a three-question survey out at the desks outside in the atrium after the worship service. You can simply fill it out, and our worship team will be there. Jolly will be there, and she'll be able to pick those up, and you'll help us to plan. We're also going to be sending out an email to you later this evening with that same survey, so that if you'd like to fill it out online, you can do it that way too. And all we're wanting to do is get your input in regards to what's next. How can we best serve you as our congregation? And then another reason for it is this. I believe that there are a number of folks who are viewing online today who are nervous about attending. And we understand it totally, don't we? And so we thought that just maybe if we had a smaller second worship service at 9:30, there may be some more folks who are viewing online that might feel more comfortable attending at that time. And then secondly, it's so good to see our young people up here. Every Sabbath, I look at them singing and leading worship, 9 and 10 of them at a time. And I'm so glad that we have young people in our church. And we want to have one service to give them an opportunity to express themselves in worship that the way that they would prefer. And then we want to have a second service for those who'd like to be a little bit more traditional and sing more hymns and have other opportunities to be able to participate in different ways. And so that's the purpose of the survey. Would love for you to fill that out if you're interested in that second worship service. We want to know how many would be interested in it so that we can begin planning it to start in the near future. We also have Pastor Grant and Bonnie right over here, and they are leading the charge on our church photo directory. It's that time again, you know, in a large congregation where we need to build community and help to get to know one another and be a part of something that's exciting and growing. And so Pastor Grant is taking photos each and every Sabbath before the worship service and afterwards. And you're welcome to go out and get that photo. It'll just take a few minutes. There is an online form that we've already sent out now for the past couple of weeks where you can fill in all the information ahead of time. And all you need to do is go in to where Pastor Grant is, click that photo, and we'll get you in our church directory. And if there are some that are viewing online here today who still are not comfortable worshiping in person but would like to be a part of the photo directory, all you have to do is call the church office and set up an appointment with Pastor Grant, and he'll take your picture in the safety of just a few people being there in the room, you and him and the camera. And so we'd love to get this photo directory going. I know during the last few weeks we've been so busy with all the activities of what's next that many of you haven't had a chance. But over the next 3 weeks or so, we'd like to see every single person, every single family be included in that photo directory. Well, we are continuing our journey through Route 66, reading through the Bible. I don't know if you joined us for the Old Testament. We've had an incredible time as we've been reading the Bible together and studying it on Wednesday evenings in our Zoom group meeting. Now we've turned the page and we're going to be in the book of Matthew today. And if you want to experience more of God in your life, I promise you that if you spend time in the Word, especially in the four Gospels that talk all about Jesus, if you're looking for more, if you're needing peace, if you're needing to find your way through these difficult times, join us in the reading through of the Scriptures. This week on Wednesday, we're going to be studying the book of Mark. It's just 16 chapters. You can read it in an hour. But I promise you that the Holy Spirit of God will make an incredible difference in your life as we go through Route 66. Let's bow our heads as we pray. Father God, we thank you that we could be together today to worship you. And we pray that this will be a very meaningful hour or so that we spend with you. And Lord, I don't know why you had me share this particular message today. There must be someone here, someone that you knew would be viewing online or here in person that needed to hear it. Because I know there are a whole lot of people that are struggling in so many ways, and they need to hear a word from you. And so as we open the book of Matthew today, may you come, may you speak, may you bless your people today as they worship you with all of their hearts. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said, amen. You know, I'd like to start with this question. Have you ever gone through a major storm in your life? Have you ever gone from calm to chaos in a single day, or maybe in a single moment? Think about your life's experience for a moment. Think about the storms that have invaded your life over your lifetime. Think about how one day you were singing and everything was going wonderfully well and life was as good as it could be, and then all of a sudden something happened. You heard some news, some diagnosis. Maybe there was a pink slip. Maybe a loved one told you that they had cancer. Whatever it was, can you think back as to how quickly life changed for you in a moment. Well, maybe you can relate to Chippy the Parakeet. This is one of my favorite all-time stories. Chippy never saw it coming. Chippy was simply perched peacefully on his swing in his cage one day when all of a sudden his owner decided that it was time to clean the cage. And you know what the lady did? She got out her vacuum and she went towards Chippy's cage, opened the door, removed the attachment on the hose of the vacuum cleaner, put the hose into the cage, turned it on, and then all of a sudden the phone rang. She turned away, picked up her cell phone, managed to click it on, said, "Hello," and all of a sudden, and she looked into the cage and Chippy was gone. Chippy was sucked up into the vacuum. And all of a sudden, the owner gasped, ran, turned off the vacuum, took the lid off the top of the vacuum, opened up the bag, and scrummaged through it all and found little Chippy. Have you ever opened up a vacuum bag? Dirty, dusty, sooty, and whatever else you can think of. Chippy was covered in all of that, and his owner was now frantic and saw that he was so dirty. She quickly ran with him to the washroom, turned on the tap, stuck him under cold water. When she took him out, he was clean. But now Chippy, you can see him there, was shivering to no end. What did his owner decide to do? She got out the blow dryer and turned it on, and it was on full speed. And poor little Chippy was blown over with all kinds of hot air just all over his body. Chippy had been sucked up, washed over, and blown dry. A reporter who reported this true story called the homeowner a few days later and said, "How is Chippy? How's he recovering?" And the owner simply replied, "Well, he doesn't sing as much as he used to anymore. He just sits there and stares." I think you can understand that, right? If you were sucked up, washed up, and if you were blown over, you might have the same experience, because that kind of scenario is probably a scenario that can take the song out of the stoutest heart. Wouldn't you agree? And so, you know, the reality is right now that we're all collectively facing an incredible storm in our world right now, aren't we? And we've been going through it for 18-19 months, whatever it's been. And I know people have all kinds of different opinions about it. Some people are not worried about it at all. Others are extremely worried, and it's affecting people in many different ways. And as a pastor, I get to bump into people from 1 to 10 on the scale. And I've discovered that there are a lot of people who are facing this incredible storm right now. But many people are also facing a serious personal storm in their lives as well. There are a lot of people going through a lot of different things. I'd like to share with you 7 things about storms. First of all, storms are a part of life. They're inevitable. If you're a human and you're alive on planet Earth, you are going to experience storms at some point in your life. And not just one storm, but likely multiple storms. Secondly, storms are expected. Storms are not an option. Everyone is going to experience storms in their lifetime, and you shouldn't be shocked when a storm comes your way. You shouldn't be surprised when life doesn't seem to be turning out the way that you had hoped or longed for it to be. Storms are to be expected. Thirdly, storms are dark and difficult, aren't they? When you're going through marriage difficulties, it's dark, difficult. When you're lying in a hospital bed the next day or so after you've had surgery, it's hard to recover back from that, isn't it? Storms are also of different intensity. Just like the hurricanes and the tropical storms that come in off the ocean and usually hit down around the Florida Keys. Storms come in different categories. Some storms that we face in life are minor storms and they're hard. And then there are some storms that are a category 5 hurricane. And when you go through those storms, it's extremely difficult to survive. 5, storms reveal what matters most. When you go through a personal storm in your life, you begin to see very clearly the things that are the most important. You begin to come to the conclusion, especially when you're seeing a loved one on the verge of dying, you begin to realize that relationships are what is most important. And if you haven't had the opportunity to discover it yet, a relationship with Jesus is the most important relationship of all in this lifetime, especially when you're going through storms. Storms also reveal what your life is built on. Storms reveal the foundation of your character. Storms reveal the foundation of your life. Is your life built on the sandy land, or is your life built on the solid rock, the Lord Jesus Christ? A storm will reveal that. When something comes and knocks you down, everyone is able to see what your foundation is in life. Everyone's able to see by how you go through the storm whether you're built on sandy land. The winds and the rains come, and the house comes tumbling down, or whether your house is built on Jesus, the solid rock. And the winds can howl, and the rains can pour down and beat down on your house, but it still remains standing during the storm. Did you see on the news just this past week in the Canary Islands with the volcanic activity that was happening there? And it showed the lava flowing all around this one house. And lava destroyed everywhere around it except for the property. And the one house is still standing there. The news reporters call it a miracle. That's what can happen when your life is built on Christ, the solid rock. Storms teach us unconditional trust in God. God is still on his throne. God is still in control. The question is for you and I, when the storms come our way, are we going to trust our God no matter what? And that's why I choose to say it. I'll say it again. People say, how are you today, Pastor Dave? What's my answer? Does anyone know? Does anyone know? Fantastic. No matter what. Fantastic. No matter what. Always good. Because God is good when? All the time. But there's something else you need to know about storms. And again, my friend in the PA booth would say, you are not going to be a motivational speaker with this one. But here it is anyway. You are either about to go into a storm, or you are in a storm, or you are coming out of a storm in your life. We live in a world that is impacted negatively in so many ways because of sin that things may be the most wonderful they could possibly be for you right now. But you may be headed towards a storm. And maybe there are some here this morning who are already in the midst of the storm. Someone viewing online today who is having a very difficult time in life. I know all kinds of stories real stories of real people in our congregation right now who are struggling in the midst of storms. And that's why I believe God led me to preach this message today. Because there's so much in the book of Matthew. Matthew is all about Jesus being the king. And not only the king, but king of kings and lord of lords of the entire universe. And so I could have preached on Jesus being the king. We could have preached on how Jesus, when he gave his greatest sermon ever, the Sermon on the Mount, shared the Beatitudes. We could have shared about the question, is this the end of time? As we studied all the signs of the times in Matthew chapter 24. But somehow in the midst of it all right now, God has led me to share with you a message about how to withstand the storms of life. If you have your Bible with you, if you want to follow along on your phone or device, the setting for this story is my favorite chapter in the entire book of Matthew. Matthew chapter 14, almost right in the center of the book. An incredible story. Jesus was ministering to a large crowd of people one day. A huge crowd of people, and he had been ministering to them all day. And he and his disciples were getting tired towards the end of the day. And Jesus heard some bad news. Some really bad news about his cousin John the Baptist and his untimely death at the hand of Herod. And it turned into a bad day. Now, some of you may study the Bible and say, Jesus didn't have any bad days. But if you study your Bible carefully, you'll discover that Jesus had numerous bad days. Can you imagine Jesus hearing the news of the death of a loved one? He reacted the same way that you would. Can you imagine Jesus leading 12? I'm trying to get the right word. 12 ragtag men as his disciples who were coming from rude, crude, fisherman, tax collector backgrounds. There are a lot of times when he probably was saying he had a bad day. And when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane praying great drops of blood, I'm not so sure that was one he would call a good day. And when Jesus died on Calvary's cross, I'm not so sure he would refer to it, as far as he was concerned himself, as a good day. It was a good day for you, a good day for me, and for every human on planet Earth, because he came to take away the sins of the entire world. But in this particular day, Matthew chapter 14, beginning in verse 13, here's what it says. When Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. And hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and he healed their sick. Now, I've been to Israel. I've been on the Sea of Galilee. It was one of the most incredible experiences of my life, being there, walking in the footsteps of Jesus. And so I can picture where Jesus was likely speaking to, teaching, and preaching to this large crowd of people that day, probably near Capernaum. And he heard this news about John the Baptist, and he decided to get into his boat and to take his disciples and to go to the other side to try and get some rest, try to get some time to think and to recharge. But it says, after the crowd heard that he told his disciples to get into the boat and to go across to the other side, the crowd decided that they were going to follow. Some may have followed in boats, and some would have walked the 10-kilometer trek around the other side. And when Jesus, it says, landed, he saw this same large crowd of people. And I love what it says next. And it's always been one of my favorite passages of the Bible. It says, and he had compassion on them and he healed their sick. You see, lost men and women and boys and girls matter to the Lord Jesus Christ more than anything. It says he was moved with compassion toward them. 82 times in the Bible, the word compassion is found. 7 times in the Gospels, we discover the word passion, and all 7 of them are in reference to Jesus having compassion toward people. The Greek word for compassion is a word that means that he was moved in the pit of his stomach. He was moved to the core of his being for people. He was groaning because he saw them come with their diseases and with all the struggles that they were having in life, and he wanted to help them. He was compelled to do something about them, to try and help them. You see, Jesus is always moved with compassion toward people. There may be a time in your life when you're going through a storm and you may feel like you've been abandoned by God. Where are you, God, when I need you the most? You may wonder if God cares. But my friend, God cares for you. Scripture tells me over and over again, 7 times in the Gospels that we are reading, and that I'm encouraging you to join me in reading together, because I know that incredible things happen in a church through the power of the Holy Spirit when people are reading the Scriptures and when they're praying and asking God to do something special in their lives. I know that. I've experienced it. Will you come and experience it with me? Jesus is always moved with compassion toward people, my friend, no matter what you're going through. Did you know that Jesus knows what it's like to wake up with a sore throat in the morning? And that's an interesting comment right now, because when we wake up with a sore throat, what do we think? Oh, no. Do you know that Jesus knows what it's like to stay up late at night when you have a colicky baby? Do you know that Jesus knows exactly what it's like when you're staying up late at night, maybe in your bed, worrying about your teen who hasn't come home yet? Jesus knows what it's like when you have a loved one who is sick, coming to the end of their journey, not wanting to eat anymore, ready to say goodbye. Jesus has experienced all those things. If anyone knows what you're going through, Jesus knows. If anyone can understand, Jesus understands. If anyone cares, Jesus cares, my friend. That's what I discovered a long time ago when I was 19 years old. I discovered how wonderful Jesus is. I discovered that Jesus is the most incredible person that anyone could ever know. That he is the great God of the universe, and that he loves me. He loves you. That he has compassion for whatever we're going through, no matter what circumstance or situation it may be. Jesus cares. Well, they must have been ministering to the people for a long time that day, because it says as evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so that they can go to the villages and buy themselves some food." And Jesus replied, "They don't need to go away. You give them something to eat." Now, if you were one of those 12 disciples, you knew that there were, scripture says, 5,000 men in the audience, not counting women and children. There were about 15,000 people. The population of the Sea of Galilee region at that time was about 25,000 people. So at least 3/5 of the population of the Sea of Galilee region were there on that hillside. And Jesus says, "You give them something to eat." Well, you can imagine their jaws dropped, their eyes popped, and they said, "Are you kidding? It's a joke, right?" But it wasn't a joke. Not at all. Because Jesus asked them, "What do you have?" And they said, we have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. 5 loaves and 2 fish for all these people? And Jesus directed the people to sit down on the grass, and taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish. And now as we begin to work our way through the story, I'd like to share with you 4 secrets to surviving the storms of life. 4 secrets to how to deal with a bad day. 4 secrets to surviving the storms of life. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and notice the red. The first thing that you need to do when you're having a bad day or going through a storm is look up to the God who cares, because he really does care for you and me. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and he broke the loaves and then he gave them to the disciples and the disciples gave them to the people. When you're going through a bad day, when you're going through a storm, no matter what it is, look up to the God who cares, because he really does care for you and me, my friend. He really does. Story continues in verse 20. It says, and they all ate and were satisfied. Whenever you are around Jesus, I can tell you, whenever you're connected to Jesus and you experience what he wants to do in your life, you'll be satisfied more than anything. I wouldn't change anything in my life's experience. I'm satisfied with where Jesus has led me so far, and hopefully you can say the same. And the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. I love the humor of God. 12 disciples, they didn't believe that any of this was going to happen at all. How are we going to feed all these people? Jesus performs a miracle, and there's one basket of reminder and remainder left over to let them know that he is who he says he is. That he is King of kings and Lord of lords. That he is able to do the impossible on planet Earth, in heaven and earth, anywhere in the entire universe, because he is the Son of the living God. And it says the number of those who ate was about 5,000 men besides women and children. And verse 22 continues, and it says, immediately Jesus made the disciples to get into the boat and to go ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. And after he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. The first thing that you need to remember to do when you're having a bad day, the first thing that you need to remember to do when you're walking through a storm of life, is to look up to the God who cares, because he really does care for you, my friend. And the second thing that you need to do is to remember to pray to the God who hears, because he really does hear and answer every single prayer. Why did Jesus go up on this mountainside all alone? He had just fed over 15,000 people. And in the parallel passage in the Gospel of John, it gives us the rest of the story. And it says that the people were so enthralled with this miracle. They were so enthralled with this Jesus that they wanted to make him king. You see, they had an enemy, the Romans, that they wanted to get rid of. They had someone who had just been martyred, John the Baptist. Now they had a leader, Jesus, and this leader could supply this army with all the food and supplies that they could possibly need. Let's make him king. And so the people started talking to the disciples. The disciples got all excited about it too. And they were going to rush him and pick him up and lift him up and make him king. But Jesus didn't come to be that kind of king, to defeat the Romans. Jesus came to defeat sin in every human soul, so that every human being could be saved in the heavenly kingdom that he was going to establish. And so Jesus, realizing what was happening with the crowd and with the disciples, he ordered his disciples to get into the boat and to sail across to the other side while he went up on top of the mountain to pray. And he was there alone. If there's one thing that the devil fears more than anything else, it's people who pray. He doesn't care what you do in your life, what a church does in its life, if we don't pray. God can do more in a moment, in the flash, in the twinkling of an eye, than you and I can do in our entire lifetime. So why don't we pray more? Why don't we open up our Bibles to Route 66? Sacrifice a little. Journey together through the Gospels. Focus our eyes on Jesus. Talk to him. That's all prayer is. Talk to him. And ask him what he wants to do in your life, in the life of your family, in the life of this church, for his glory, to the blessing of others in this world. Jesus went up on top of the mountain top to pray. He was discouraged. He was discouraged because of what happened to John the Baptist. Now he was discouraged because the people had misunderstood the whole meaning of the miracle of the feeding of the people on the mountainside. And he decided it was time to text his heavenly Father. Time to pick up his cell phone and to call home. He wanted to hear his daddy's voice. And you may doubt whether prayer works, but if you text and if you have a cell phone and you believe and know that that works and that's human made, then God's internet system of prayer works trillions of times better than your cell phone and your texting. You can call out to God anytime, anywhere. He always hears. You never get a busy signal. He always answers in the way that is best for every single prayer. So he went up into the mountainside by himself to pray. And it says, look up to the God who cares because he really does care. Pray to the God who hears because he really does hear and answer prayer. Later that night, he was there alone, and it says, and the boat was already a considerable distance from the land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. And for those of you who've heard me share some of this message before, I guess I'll do it again. There may be some who haven't heard it. I'm from Newfoundland, and I hung around with the fishermen in Marystown, Newfoundland, the fishing capital of the world, and I went into homes, and I didn't understand what they were saying, and they'd say, "Bye, there's a tizzard blowing from the north." A tizzard blowing from the north. A blizzard blowing from and the disciples were out there on the Sea of Galilee in this tizzard. And Jesus was up on top of the mountain praying because Jesus believed in the power of prayer. He realized that no matter what the chaos and the confusion of earth's problems, you can find God's solution when you pray. And I know that there are some people here today and some people viewing online who doubt that. You've not had that experience. But I believe every single word of Scripture, and Scripture tells me that when we come to God and we ask and believe, we can claim. And He does answer every single prayer. He answered it in His time and in His way. But He answers every single prayer. But let me ask you, what was Jesus praying about? I can't prove it 100%, but I make the assumption that he was praying and asking God for strength and courage for himself. He was praying and asking God that the people might understand more clearly who he was and what he was about. And then thirdly, I think he was praying for the disciples out of the storm. Because in the previous verse, it says he was up on the mountain alone and he saw them buffeted by the waves out there in the desert. Jesus prays for you. He intercedes for you. Jesus especially is praying for you and me when we walk through a storm. Verse 24 continues, it says, but the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. It was stormy. These sailors were out there and they were frightened. These fishermen had been on the sea before, but now they were in fear. The waves were high. The water was coming in, going to swamp their boat. And they were afraid for their lives. And it says, and in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. Now they likely set sail to cross the other side at sunset. And it says, Jesus came to them in the fourth watch of the night. Do you know when that is? That's between 3 a.m. and 6 a.m. They had been rowing out there trying to keep their boat afloat in the storm for 9 hours, likely. And Jesus came to them walking on the sea in the fourth watch of the night. Have you ever noticed that when you're going through terrible storms, that sometimes it's hard to sleep? And in the wee hours of the morning, it's the darkest when you're most depressed and afraid. I've certainly noticed that in the wee hours of the morning, if my telephone rings, it's likely not good news. And by the way, don't try to call me at 3 a.m. unless it's an emergency. Says, and in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled. You'd be troubled too. And they said, it's a spirit, a ghost. Now, it only had been 9 hours. You think they would have recognized him, right? But when you and I are going through a storm for 9 hours or 9 days, we tend to forget what Jesus looks like because quite often we're not focused on the Savior. We're focused on the storm. I heard an incredible story there. It was actually on the news, and it was a while ago now, a few years ago, and someone said, Jesus didn't walk on water. What's the matter with you Christians? He walked on ice. Well, I am not sure exactly what the disciples were doing rowing on ice. And Peter must have been a whole lot heavier than Jesus because he fell through the ice and cried for God to save him. They said it's a spirit and they cried out for fear. But straightway, Jesus spoke unto them saying, here's the third secret. Be of good cheer. It is I. Be not afraid. Be of good cheer. It is I. Just continue believing in who I am. Now, if a pastor came and said those words to you and you're in the middle of the storm, yeah. Or if a relative came and said those words to you in the middle of the storm. But my friend, when Jesus comes and he says, be of good cheer, it is I. He is in that statement telling you who he is. He is the great I am. The name of God himself in scripture. And he says, no matter what, be of good cheer. Believe. Do not be afraid, for I'm with you. Look up to the God who cares, because he really does care. Pray to the God who hears, because he really does hear and answer prayer. And no matter what, say you're fantastic. Be of good cheer, because Jesus says, it is I. Be not afraid. What did Jesus do during the storm? First of all, Jesus came to them. Secondly, he came to them personally. Thirdly, he came to them in their darkest hour, in the wee hours of the morning when they were at their worst. Jesus came to them just when they needed him most. For some reason, he likes to do it that way. Just when you need him most. Is the song going through your mind? Just when I need him. Jesus came to them walking victoriously over their greatest fears. They were afraid the water, the winds were going to come and swamp their boat and they were going to drown. And Jesus said, don't worry about it. It is I. Be not afraid. And he walked on top of their greatest fears. Now, let me tell you something. When you have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, you don't have to be afraid of anything. Whatever your greatest fear may be right now in the midst of any storm that you have gone through or are going through right now or will go through in the future, Jesus can help you conquer that fear. You see, even the darkest hours of the night cannot hide you from the face of God. In the darkest hour of life, God is still God, and he is still in control. But unfortunately, their attention was on the storm instead of the Savior. Sometimes we do exactly the same thing. We need to remember to look up to the God who cares, because he really does care, to pray to the God who hears, because he really does hear and answer prayer. We need to be of good cheer. Be not afraid. Best part of the story. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me come unto thee on the water. And Jesus said, come. Just one word, come. Jesus told Lazarus to come forth. Jesus told Zacchaeus to come down. And now he's telling Peter to come out on the waters. And just in case you need a more personal invitation, he says in Matthew chapter 11 and verse 28 to 30, he says it to you and to me. The good days and the bad days of life, he says, come unto me, all ye who are weary and heavy laden. Take my yoke upon you. My burden is light. And you will find what? Rest unto your souls. It says, and when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. quite often, miracles do not occur in the kiddies pool. If you want to experience the miracles of God in your life, you've got to be willing to get out of the boat in the deep water. The Sea of Galilee was 10 kilometers wide, 15, 16 kilometers long, and 157 feet deep. And Jesus came to them in the middle of the night, in the middle of the storm, quite likely in the middle of the Sea of Galilee when it was its deepest. And Peter, you got to give him credit. We just give him credit for sinking. We need to start giving him credit for walking on the water. He walked on the water to go to Jesus, but when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and beginning to sink. He cried out, saying, "Lord, save me!" You've likely cried out a prayer like that at one time in your life or another. But you need to realize that never did a soul cry for help to be saved, to be rescued, and it went unheard. Wow. But I need to ask you again, if Jesus were to call you to come out into the unknown and to walk on the water, would you go? There were 12 disciples and only one took up the invitation to walk above it all. What an incredible feeling it is, you know, when you know Jesus and you're able to walk above it all. You're able to walk above cancer, coronavirus, crisis in your marriage and family, and even in your career. If Jesus were to call you to come be a part of a church family to prepare for the second coming, would you come? If Jesus were to call you to step into the water and be baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, would you come? Peter chose to come. But Peter had a problem. He had an eye problem. It says he took his eyes off Jesus and he began to focus on the circumstances around him, a move that will cause you to start sinking every time. Whenever you take your eyes off Jesus and you try to do life on the sea of life in your own boat by yourself, the winds and the waves are high and dangerous. And there are things happen that are beyond your control. It's a whole lot better being in the boat with Jesus than being out there on the sea of life all by yourself. 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 18 says this to you and me. The Apostle Paul wrote these words. He said, "So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." Fix your eyes upon Jesus. And immediately, I love those two words. Peter says, "Lord, save me." And immediately it says, Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, "O thou of little faith, wherefore didst thou doubt?" And when they were coming to the ship, the wind ceased. When you're in the boat with Jesus, the wind ceases, no matter what you're facing. Be because you know that the things of this world are just temporary, but the things of Jesus are eternal. The things that matter most in the midst of the storm is your relationship with others, and most of all, your relationship with Jesus. That's why here at Church in the Valley, we choose every week to say we love God, we love people, and we serve the world. Then they that were in the ship came and worshiped him, saying of a truth, thou art the Son of God. The first thing that you need to do when you're dealing with a bad day is, when you're dealing with the storms of life, look up to the God who cares, because he really does care. Don't doubt that. Pray to the God who hears. You keep praying, even if it feels your prayers aren't going above the ceiling. Pray, because he really does hear and answer prayer every time you send a text. Remember, prayer works even more than a text message. And thirdly, no matter what, be of good cheer, because Jesus says, it is I. Be not afraid. And fourthly, worship the God who is near. You see, when it's all said and done, the greatest danger in life is not the storm around you, but rather the storm within you. You can go through any physical storm if Jesus has calmed the storm inside of you. And you know, you've heard me say it before, I compare the church to a ship that is setting sail for the heavenly harbor, and it's going to set sail one day very soon. And two goals. First of all those on board the ship lift up Jesus Christ higher than he could possibly be ever lifted and worship him every day and especially every Sabbath together. And then secondly, for that ship to be so full that there are people hanging onto the mast and hanging onto the sides and there's standing room only because they've all fallen in love with Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. And because no matter what storms they go through in life, they are able to say, it is well with my soul.
Church, let's stand together as we continue to worship this morning.
With my soul, with my Take me deeper
Shall we bow our heads as we pray? Almighty God, we thank you that we could worship you today. We pray that your Holy Spirit would remind us how to withstand the storms of life, the four secrets to look up to the God who cares because he really does care, to pray to the God who hears because he really does hear and answer every prayer, no matter what, to be of good cheer because it is I, the great I am, that says to continue to believe and be not afraid. And fourthly, to worship the God who is near, right in the middle of the night, in the middle of the sea, and in the middle of the storm. May every single one of us be able to take your words and not only hear them, but to live them out in the midst of the storms. When we get upset or angry or we're afraid, help us to rest in your embrace and to know that you are ours and we are yours, and that you can give us safety, strength, and victory through the storm. All these things we pray in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit of God. And everyone said, Amen.
I turn to you, put everything behind me, and found the God who makes all things new. I look to you, drowning in my questions, and found the God who holds all wisdom. And I trusted you and stepped out on the ocean. You caught my hand among the waves, 'cause you're the God of all.